Star Wars CCG community. This week we have a amazing video. So, my personal 12 favorite Star Wars CCG cards of all time. And this ranking is basically on aesthetics. It's very subjective and my memories with the cards. So, that's what the ranking's like. And I'm also going to go over four different cards I really don't care for, or themes about Star Wars CCG I really don't care for. But there's so much to love about Star Wars CCG. So comment below and win a premier limited starter deck. All you got to do is tell me your favorite card, or tell me your least favorite card, or tell me, say whatever you want. That's up to you. So now we got to get to something very important. Super Hunks of the Empire. Okay, so this week, last week we were down to our final four, and it was General VEERS versus Captain Nita, and General VEERS destroyed Captain Nita just by like 30 votes, and so General VEERS took that. I knew, pretty sure General VEERS was going to win, but I didn't see that big of a blowout, so General VEERS in the final two. Next, we had such a heated, close match, Captain Lennox versus Moff JERJERROD. Captain Lennox lost by 2 votes, putting Moff JERJERROD versus General VEERS, the final two. So go, there's going to be a link below. Just go vote. This is it. This is the final two. Who's the super hunk of the galaxy? I mean, I know VEERS is the favorite, but Moff JERJERROD, he could be the sleeper. You never know. So place your bets now. Let's start off this list appropriately with, of course, Jar Jar Binks, coming in at the number 12th card of my favorite cards. Jar Jar Binks, iconic character, can never have too many of them in a deck. He deploys like a spy, but he's not a spy. He blows up. I went over this in my first video. Power 3, Ability 3, Jar Jar, classic. The CGI on Jar Jar Binks is done so well, you really can't tell that it's computer generated. That's the amazing thing about Episode 1. The CGI is so well done that you would say, oh my goodness, this looks like puppets. It looks just like Jim Henson was there making puppets. They're really interacting with these characters. Doesn't look fake at all, especially Jar Jar Binks. Really well done. Really well done character. Hilarious. Misa Binks? That was a little boss nass for you. Now, coming in at number 11, the Stalker. So this is kind of a repeat of my favorite from the Hoth set too. One of my favorite cards because it's my favorite icon, the favorite picture of the Star Destroyer where it's head-on. And I like how they took out the Millennium Falcon there. It's that shot where they're chasing the Millennium Falcon. And it was my first unique Star Destroyer I pulled from a pack. Just have a soft spot in my heart for this card. It was basically the first really cool card I pulled from a pack. And I was like 12 and I was ecstatic. So this is the actual card I pulled from that pack, to be honest. I know it's that one because I kept it in the special binder. Has a special place in my heart. Went over it in the Star Destroyer video. So that's coming in at 11. Now, number 10. We have Yoda. This card is iconic. It has the Force icon instead of a rebel or an alien symbol. It has the Force icon. That blew me away when it came out. That's so cool. You get to activate a Force just like you who's playing the game. It's kind of almost saying, yeah, you are a Jedi Master too because you're activating a Force for yourself. Deploying Dagobah I must, but move elsewhere I may. I love how they do the whatever the Yoda speak throughout the text. Deploy for 5, forfeit 9, and he's very deck specific. He doesn't have the most uses, but you gotta love the Yoda. Now that is a Jim Henson puppet, and he does look badass, and he's immune to all attrition. You can plop him down, and I know people had strategies where they'd get him off Dagobah, do crazy things with him, because he had so many strategies that you could do with him if you got him off Dagobah. It was kind of a pain in the ass, but once you got him off, it was really cool to do. Yoda, number 10, love the Yoda, love the card. All around great card. Now, number 9. The more we get into these, the more I love these. The more I love these cards. This card, I swear I still run two of these in all my dark side deck. Or at least one. I just love Presence of the Force. Such a cool concept. Deploy on any location. Add one dark side icon, one light side icon. Just simple. Just a simple card. It makes you so you can deploy anywhere you want. Stop some of their little shenanigans if they're at a place, like inside some place where you can't deploy and they don't think you can get there. Throw down one of these bad boys. Adds to force drains. Can't be canceled when you have those effects that say cancel all force drain modifiers. It's not a force drain modifier. It's just straight up force. I love this card. It's not cumulative, which I learned later on, but Presence of the Force, rare one, great card, a premier card, which is going to be a theme here. There's lots of premier cards on my favorite cards. Love this card's iconic sabers clashing against each other. Coming in at number 9, Presence of the Force. Very cool card. Number 8. So this is Calphon Condor. See, I don't even know how to say it. I should have looked it up before. Somebody should correct me and show me how you actually say this. We just called her Legs. It was Legs. It was Legs. It was Mother of Power 8 Ability 1. We didn't have... So for Legs and Power 8 Ability 1, we just called them Power 8 Ability 1 and Legs because we had no idea how to say their names. And this card, it basically was like my Presence of the Force 2. I swear I put it in every single deck, and I can't get away from it. If I have an extra space in a deck, I'm throwing in this lady. And the picture is so awesome. I like how they just have the legs there. Who Star Wars CCG was really creative in pulling aliens out of just the smallest scenes. And it's like, we're going to make a character out of that. And guess what? It can't board an airplane, and has also opponent's destiny is reduced to 0 if yours is higher. Wow, what a great card. If you know you're going to get a high destiny, if you tracked a destiny and you know you're going to get one high destiny, it can be brutal for them. Oh, and a little bonus to this card. Ooh, deploy for 0. Wow. Forfeit 5. It's just a damage soaking up. Great character. It doesn't even matter if you don't use it. You could use it with, say, Mantillion Saver in your hand, and you have 5 forfeit. It's got a lot of uses. Destiny 2 adds 2 to the power only of a capital ship. Love Legs, rare one from Premier. Love this card. Couldn't get away from it. Still can't get away from it. It's Legs. Somebody tell me how to say it. It's Legs. All right, what number am I on? What number? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, yes. Number 7. Coming in, number 7, Black 2. Another premier card, a spaceship. Okay, yeah. It's not very good. Yeah, it sucks. It's a terrible card. But that picture is the coolest, iconic, most iconic picture of a TIE fighter there is. When I think TIE fighter, I think Black 2. DS-612 pilots it. It sucks. No hyperdrive. And you have to add a pilot, so it's not a very good card unless you have effects or interrupts with it, which is a shame. It's a rare one. I remember pulling it from a starter deck and just loving this card. And my brother had it before me, and I was always jealous of his Black 2. Little did I know a regular common X-Wing is better than it. But, yeah, it really is a shame. I guess they gave it one more maneuver. They didn't want to make it too powerful, you know. And they didn't want to have any game text on it, you know. We have the coolest picture ever, but... Heaven forbid we put a little game text on there. No, we have tons of flavor text on Black 2, but not any actual text. Deploy for 1, forfeit 3. Great card. That iconic photo is just what makes it so cool. Love this card. It probably should be higher on the list, but it does so little, and it's so hard to make useful. DS-612 is much better card than that, than his ship, but... I love that card. So, next, 1, 2, coming in at number 6, we have, kind of in the same vein, another rare one from Premier, the original, the OG Millennium Falcon. Look at that photo. It's a beast. Now, this is a ship that isn't worthless. It is amazing. Deploy for 3, forfeit 7, power 3, maneuver 4, hyperspeed 6. It can do the Kessel Run in whatever parsecs, which doesn't even make sense. I know it's been said a million times. Cool card, great, especially once you had the Death Star 2 effect where you can pull pilots and you can pull your Han or you can pull your Lando or whatever. Just a great card. Such a cool image. Kind of like with the same vein as Black 2. Iconic. Well, I never got one of these when I was younger. I always was trying to get one in a pack. I think it might have been one of the last rare ones I got in Premier, and I didn't actually have a Millennium Falcon till maybe 6 years ago, which is a shame because I always wanted one, and I never had one, so I had to always fly my characters around in Corvettes, which is a damn shame. But now that I have one, it's mine. It's one of the coolest cards there is. Premier rare one, another Premier. Now that I'm looking at it, I have a lot of Premier in my top cards. Anyway, to take a break from the top to the top list, let's, since we have five cards left in the top five of my favorite cards, let's go over four of my least favorite cards of all time. Least favorite cards. So they're increasing with how much I do not like them. I actually do not like Monok, and I do not like what is the other? I can't even think of the counterpart for it. Well, you know what I'm saying. Grimtash. Grimtash. The used portion is okay. That would be fine. 13 or more cards in your hand. Place all but 8 in your used pile. This lost part, it's too good. I think it ruins too many decks. You want to make a trooper deck? Sorry, you can't make a trooper deck. Use 4 force to call all to cause all opponents to reveal their hands. All opponent cards that have 2 or more are lost. So basically, you can't have any repeats in your hand. So I remember playing a deck where I needed a Hoth Perimeter 3 for the dark side really bad. And so I had 2 Perimeter 3, Marker 3 sites in my deck. And I just happened to draw them on the first turn. And they happened to Grimtash me the first turn. So I lost both of them. So instead of like getting to draw my card and getting to play my Marker 3, it actually punished me. And it felt so wrong. Like, why just because how lucky or unlucky you are, you lose cards in your hand. Especially if you have 1 or 2 in your deck. It just seems like an ungodly penalty. Plus, it ruined so many strategies. They had to come out with Well Guarded. So, starting in Jabba's Palace and afterwards, you had to start out with Well Guarded. And that wastes your starting interrupt. You could have Thieves' Den or something like that, but you have to start out with Well Guarded because a Monok or Grimtash is too devastating. And it just really pigeonholed a lot of strategies where it said, hey, you have to go mains. Sorry, you have to use mains. It kind of stinks. You want to use your Cloud City Trooper deck? No, sorry. You got a Monok or Grimtash. I guess I could see maybe 4 force to cause opponent to reveal hands. All cards opponent has 2 or more of that are unique characters are lost. That would be great. I would like that change more. Kind of penalizes mains decks, but you know, mains and toys is what they wanted to push. Don't like that card. So, getting more egregious. This is in Dagobah. I freaking hate the insert cards. Never Tell Me the Odds, Anger, Fear, Aggression. What are the dark side versions of it? 3,720 to 1. Such, I see where they're coming from. And in that interview with, I forget the guy's name, but the guy who designed the set, it wasn't intended to be this abused. It was to make droids useful. The effect is to make droids useful. Yeah, droids suck, but they have high destinies. Maybe you can make them lose a few force. But then it just turned into people had these bizarre manipulation decks. You'd start out with the Djeric board. You'd force drain on the Djeric board. You'd use surprise assaults. You would then sit droids just on the table with their Destiny 5s and 4s, and you would just sit there on a spaceship or on a location they can't get to, or because you can't battle the droids, and then you'd stick these in their decks all game with anger, fear, aggression, so they would lose 10 force whenever one came to the top. Oh, it's immune to alter. Why would you make this immune? You made every other card not immune to alter. Now the most, I guess you don't want to make something alterable if it's already in your reserve deck, because then you got to go get it. I think their logic that's the logic behind making all these insert cards immune to alter. But it's so powerful that you got to have a way to cancel it easy. It's an unnecessary, unfun card, just like Anger, Fear, Aggression. You got both those in your deck, and they're losing 10, 14 force every 3 turns, or they can't power up. Plus, they're getting surprise assault. It's kind of nonsense, and it made you just have to have one more effect in your deck that canceled it. So it was, you just had to have one more card in your deck to make sure you can't get Never Tell Me the Odds. Didn't like that. Now, getting more egregious. This it's not necessarily that I hate this card. It was just a preview for what's to come. R2 D2 in red 5. Okay, yeah, R2, I really liked that he had a Destiny 2 and a Destiny 5, and then I liked the R2 in Jabba's Palace that had a Destiny 1 or Destiny 6. That's cool. Because the card's not that useful. So you can give it a cool Destiny because R2 is not that great of a card. I guess I like the R2 from New Hope. I think he's killer on red 5, but how about we just have a card that's Destiny 0 and Destiny 7? Wow. How fair is that? Okay, so everybody can track it and have it in their training decks. The best card, oh, by the way, deploys for 4, and you can deploy Luke free aboard it. And combined with the Death Star 2 effect where you pull a pilot, it's like, here you go, light side. Have another Super Falcon. As if Dark Side Space wasn't bad enough already. Had to deal with the Super Falcon. Now you have to deal with R2-D2 in Red 5. Not as bad as the Super Falcon, but you don't have to have the Destiny 0-7. I know it's a cool gimmick, but just have an R2-D2 with 0-7. Not have one of the best ships in the game with a 7 Destiny. Anyway, it's not nearly as bad as, say, the Reflections 3 card of Han and Chewie in the Millennium Falcon, which is just gross. Which brings me to my number one offending card of all time that makes me relch when I see it. I hate it. I hate all Reflections 3 overpowered garbage. And this is the biggest offender. I just mentioned Han, Louie, and the Falcon. Sounds like a 50s bebop band or something. No, Han, Chewie, and the Falcon. Blizzard 4. I hate this card. It is so silly. Okay, power 8. Okay, armor 4. Okay, so they armor 4. I guess it doesn't have super high armor. Land speed 1. Deploy for 5. Forfeit 5. Okay, so it's one cheaper than a Let's make it one cheaper than a regular walker. Okay, that sounds fair. Permanent pilots provide ability 4, because that makes sense. Because all permanent pilots should have ability 4, just like they did in Blizzard 2 and Blizzard 1. No, wait. Blizzard 1 didn't even have a permanent pilot. When deployed, by the way, that was a joke. Blizzard 2 has ability 2. When deployed, you may deploy for free an Imperial Warrior aboard from your reserve deck. So you don't even have to have this card in your hand. It's basically a puller. It pulls whatever guy you want, Darth Vader, the Emperor, Darth Maul, and, oh no, not Darth Maul, sorry, Imperial. And you get to deploy him for free because that makes sense. And the logic behind it probably is, well, they're inside of it, so you can't really battle with it. You have to disembark during your move phase. Don't care. You can plop this down on turn 1 or turn 2. And I guess they have these small penalties where you use one force or else it dies. What is this upkeep mechanic? What I hate, it's not, this isn't magic. This upkeep mechanic. It's so silly. Lando enraged, Chewie enraged, Jar Jar Binks enraged. I know there's only a few of them, but it's such a power creep card. It's up there with the P-59 and P-60s that make them lose force when they're hit. It's such a power creep card, and it makes so many cards terrible. And might as well make it a 4 Destiny, because why not? It's a 4 Destiny because it's Blizzard 4. It's thematic. Yeah, this should deploy for about 15. This should deploy more for than the Executor. Stupid card. Stupid set. I'm getting upset just talking about it. Anyway, and you have to balance around that card from then. You have to make your deck balanced around these Reflections 3 cards, which after Reflections 3 Coruscant, Theed's Palace, it really made your decks changed everything. Now, let's get a little more positive. Now we got the top 5, my favorite top 5 cards of all time. Number 5, coming in at 5, a Reflections 3 card, and I was just crapping myself about how much I don't like Reflections 3. I love this card. Foil, 3PO with his parts showing, iconic card, ultra rare, special place in my heart. It's a couple other people's favorite cards, I know, and it used to not be my favorite until I got... Tell somebody explain to me how cool it was and just how the foil looks on... It's hard to see. When you have the 3PO, his parts showing. It's a cool foil. It's my favorite foil. So, and it was one of the last cards I got in the set. Plus, 3PO with his part showing is a really cool card concept where you get to move your cards around and you have to have Shmi and you move stuff around. But ultra rare, cool card. I like how they didn't make the ultra rare some kind of really good, I mean, not saying it's a bad card, but they didn't make it some insane card like some insane Yoda or something. They just made it 3PO with his part showing. Like it. Number four, my favorite card. So this is Japanese Hoth misprint E-Web Blaster. The reason why it gets number four, it was the very last card I got to obtained to complete my Master Set collection. I has a special place in my heart. I got it about 3-4 years ago now. It took me forever to track this stupid thing down. And once I did, it was the last card I quote-unquote needed for my set, unless somebody finds another errata, like they just found the Turn It Off, or not errata, or finds another air card like they found in like the Turn It Off. Some of them have a little tiny superscript zero written in the text. But until they find another card with an air, I hope they do. I would love somebody to say, oh, there's a misprint in XYZ set, and you know what? You don't have your set complete. But as far as my set goes, this was the last card I needed to complete it, and that's why it has a special place in coming in at number four. Number three, Duntooine-based operations. I know you all saw this coming. This is one of my favorite cards because I think it's a very well-balanced objective. Maybe each Imperial deploy plus two is a little strong, but I played this objective ad nauseum, still play it. As soon as Special Edition came out, it was the first objective I pulled from a pack, and I was hooked on it. I love the Rebel theme. I love trying Troopers on it. I love trying Biker Scout, what did I try on it? I've tried Pilots on it, where the Power 2 ability 2 Pilots. I've tried Mains on it. Permanent weapons on it. I've tried the space deck version, and when you flip it, you get the squadrons, but you don't have to do the squadrons. It's a fun objective. It isn't as abusive as like the operatives, and it's not as good as Raltar Ops. And I just love Dantooine Ops, and I ran it so much, that's why I put it at number three. Probably not the most exciting one on the list, but it has a very special place for my Star Wars CCG collecting. Number two, and you guessed it, this is two cards. These are two cards of my favorite card. You can't see that, that's kind of glary. So the white bordered Executor, this is one of the coolest looking cards there is, coming in at number two, tied with Death Star and the Death Star white border. I love the Executor white border. I don't know, there's something about it. It looks so cool. It's just that iconic ship. And it's white bordered. I don't know. And even a little bit more so is the Death Star white bordered. If I can have Death Star as my starting location, I am making this white border one my starting location. It looks badass. Three for you, none for them. The white border just goes, makes that Death Star a little more ominous. I love it. I try to run it as much as I can. Sometimes if you're running a Premier through Death Star 2 deck, it's kind of hard to fit in your deck, but anything from Premier to Jabba's Palace, you got to have room in this if you're playing one of those formats. Put this card in your deck. Looks awesome. It's not rare one. It's not rare two like in regular. And not in regular New Hope, it was a rare two, the Death Star. This is just a rare. In the unlimited sets, they got rid of the rare one and rare two, which arguably is a good thing. So I blathered and bloviated long enough. Where is the number one card? And you all saw it coming. My favorite card of all time, DS613 Premier Rare One, the ultimate badass card. That picture is my favorite picture of all Star Wars CCG. You got that blue light. It looks so sinister. It's the most the way they did the Imperial pilots costumes in A New Hope, and I guess all the movies, but are just some of my favorite. They're better than Stormtrooper outfits. They're better than Vader's costume, in my opinion. It is the best looking dark character there is. It's just like they're in space. They're in these little capsules. They have the black eyes, and that's just the coolest picture of an Imperial pilot. Plus, rare one, DS613, such a cool name. Deploy for 2, forfeit 3, power 3, ability 2. It's not that terrible as 3 to the power of anything he pilots. A warrior, rare 1, premier set, right up there. Back in the day with black 2, those used to be my two favorite cards. It was always, I guess, DS613 has black 3, which is uncommon, and DS612, which is uncommon, has the rare 1 ship. Maybe it would have been cool if DS613 had the rare TIE fighter. I don't know. Love this card. So iconic. Every time I see it, it makes me smile. My favorite card. It's old, you can tell. It's one of my... I used it a lot. I use it in, I put it, in, just like with Presence of the Force, I try to put it in every single deck possible. So, that's the list. I want to hear what your favorite cards are. I mean, why? Nostalgia reasons. Not because they're good. I don't want to hear you say Super Luke. But maybe it is your favorite card because you pulled them on your first pack of Death Star 2. That's why. I want to hear why your favorite card is. Give me some weird ones. Give me some obscure ones. I would love to hear them. And thanks for listening to my list. So, let's go over comments from last week. And seriously, there were some great comments. Some of the best comments I've ever gotten. And that's saying a lot. And I really appreciate it. And I love reading these. And I bet other people do too. So, first thing, why don't we do Rebel Hunks? We should do Rebel Hunks. That's a fantastic idea. And yeah, you can't do Wedge. You can't have Han. You can't have Chewie. You can't have Lando. It would be a wash. They're too much of a Hunks. You have to have the shy guys, the, you know, the unspoken heroes, the Pops, the Bigs, the Dak, the, you know, the unspoken heroes of the Rebel Alliance, because there's too many Hunks. There's too many main character Hunks. Anyway, I get sidetracked by that. So, a lot of people disagreed with my list of... I was ranking the sets last week, and people disagreed with my rankings. Some people were very close to my rankings. A lot of people put Special Edition a lot lower, especially citing that they did not like the way the pictures and the graphics look. And yes, they are more grainy. I don't know if that has to do with Special Edition itself or just... they weren't using the actual film stock to make the pictures, but the cards look worse. People said Premier has so many wasted cards, and I agree. Premier has so many wasted cards. Somebody would say, so another comment said, pulling cards out of Premier pack was just like basically like the lottery, and I completely agree. So when I first got into Star Wars, I was 10 or 11 or something, right when Premier came out, and a little after Premiere, and me and my brothers would go to the card shop, and we'd have enough money from allowance to buy one starter deck a week, or like two packs. So we'd always buy a starter pack. Had no cards. So I pulled complete garbage from my packs. And I kid you not, one of the first starter decks we ever bought, my brother pulls, you know how the two rares are around the rules? He pulls Darth Vader and Obi-Wan. Same starter deck. How could I ever compete with his decks after that? Especially when I think it was only Premier through Hoth were out at the time. So, yeah, I lost a lot of games after that. Anyway, people love opening Death Star 2 packs. I didn't think about this aspect. Death Star 2 are super fun packs to open because it's not like Jabba's Palace where you always get an alien or something like that. It's like there's a chance you're going to get an okay card, but there's also a great chance you get ultra rare, or there's so many useful cards, or a super cool spaceship, or Saber 1 or whatever. That's a very good point. Let's see. I got like four comments that said they left the game either from Dagobah to Death Star 2. A lot of people quit the game. And that's probably, one person said it because it just got too expensive to keep up with the game. You had to have all the sets. That's true. And the rules got so much more convoluted. I feel like a lot of people exited the game from that time. I mean, I exited the game right when Tatooine came out. I said, that's enough of this. But I mean, I got back into the game, obviously, and I love Tatooine now. So anyway, A New Hope and Premiere are tons of fun to play in a theme format where you're trying to destroy the Death Star and protect it. Yeah, that's a good point. So somebody said A New Hope was their favorite because of that reason. It's a good point. It is very fun to play New Hope themed decks. So, thanks for the comments. Can't wait to hear your comments this week. And now, let's draw the winner of the starter deck for this week. Maybe you'll get an Obi-Wan and Vader in there. That'll just make your life. Jiggly PKMN. I'm assuming the PKMN stands for Pac-Man or some kind of business type thing. I'm not sure. I don't know what it means, but thank you for the great comment. The comment says, I got to admit, I was staring at my computer at work, wondering when this week's video would come out. I'm not disappointed. Thank you very much for that comment. Just made my day. I really appreciate it. I'm an extreme outlier. Dagobah was my favorite, with New Hope close second. Thinking about it more, I really like Dagobah. I think I did it a wrong and a dirty, and it should be actually above Cloud City and maybe up equal to Jabba's Palace. I was thinking about it. I really do love Dagobah more than Cloud City. I don't know why I rated it below it. It has, maybe it's a worse set, but it does have a place in my heart. Anyway, thanks for the comment. You won the starter deck. Comment below. Win one this week. Next week, we have a great video. Secret video, and we have the finals between General VEERS, Moff JERJERROD, the two titans of the hunk world in Star Wars. Oh my gosh, this video has gone too long. Thank you very much, and we'll talk soon.